when we all work together for the greater good. Can look past what's wrong or misunderstood. We can work together and get through the hardest part. Bring a home to a helpless and empty heart. You can make a difference and save a life if you can. Believe it.
May God be with you. Good morning. Welcome to worship at Mount Olivet Lutheran Church of Plymouth. That song, Believe It, written by our own JC on piano and voice. I'm grateful for all the gifts that our musicians bring and grateful for all the gifts that you bring in your various roles in all the places that you are called in the world. And now you are called here together in many places to hear the promise of God that restores us to new life. Every Sunday is a little Easter. Even in Lent, we don't count Sundays as part of the 40 days of Lent because Sundays are always Easter, but we are in the season of Easter as well. 50 days, it's not just the big holiday. All this time to soak in the promise of God's life rising all around us. God's life isn't the only thing that's rising. COVID-19 case levels are also rising. So you will see a basically empty worship center this morning. We have moved into our yellow phase of our COVID-19 preparedness plan. And that means while we are inside, we will not be able to welcome folks in worship. And starting next week, it is our intention to begin worshiping outside, and we will be able to welcome you then in person or online or over the phone to worship. So I know Pastor Beth will talk a little bit more about that, but wanted to get that on your radar. There are many signs of new life around us, but the biggest sign in this church happens right over here at this font. Our new life in Christ begins when we are claimed fully and wholly in our baptism. And so during this season, we light the candle and we gather at the font to give thanks to God for the gift of baptism. So please join me. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Refreshed by the resurrection life we share in Christ, let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We thank you, risen Christ, for these waters where you make us new, leading us from death to life, from tears to joy. We bless you, risen Christ, that your spirit comes to us in the grace-filled waters of rebirth, like rains to our thirsting earth, like streams that revive our souls, like cups of cool water shared with strangers. Breathe your peace on your church when we hide in fear. Clothe us with your mercy and forgiveness. Send us companions on our journey as we share your life. Make us one, risen Christ. Cleanse our hearts, shower us with life. To you be given all praise with the Holy Spirit in the glory of God, now and forever. Amen. Let us sing together. Let us pray. God of the dawn, keep breathing your Holy Spirit into our fear-filled lungs. Awaken us to receive the gifts of one another, to see beyond what we see now. Stay with us, O God, as you call us to take the next step. In Jesus' name, amen.
The reading for today comes from the 20th chapter of John, beginning at the 19th verse. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who is called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my fingers in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was among them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed me because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thanks, Bob, for being here to read today. Let's pray. God, you promise when your story is told that your Spirit will come. We doubt it. We question it. We wonder if it's true. So we come today and trust that it is true. Send your Spirit within us, upon us. Hold us, God, and send us out. Amen. John could have ended this story at verse 23. It would have been a fine story of the resurrected Jesus coming to the disciples as they hide in fear, and then in that moment, breathing into them the Holy Spirit. And we could have just assumed that all the disciples were there that day to receive this promise and call from Jesus. But John must have felt that leaving the story there would miss a key part of resurrection, because not everyone was there that day. Thomas had to hear from the other disciples that they had seen the Lord. And hearing about it wasn't enough. So Thomas had the guts to demand that he too be a part of the experience of seeing firsthand the crucified and risen Jesus. And somehow, Jesus knew as well that something was incomplete. Someone was missing. Because he showed up again, this time Thomas was there to see for himself that resurrection did not erase the humanness of Jesus. The marks of death remained on the body of the one who had personally called Thomas and the others from the beginning. who had fed, healed, and taught, going out to encounter regular people and places to proclaim that God had come for them. And so, every year, this is the gospel story, the Sunday after Easter. I don't think the resurrection story is finished without its telling. I remember July 2016, Bishop Ann Svenningsen came to Mount Olivet. A large group gathered in the fireside room. She wanted to get to know us, to hear about our mission in this little corner of Plymouth, where we have experienced God, where we were feeling called, and what was important as we looked to call a new associate pastor. She then asked us to be open to all candidates. She was not vague in the language she used. She said, "I want you to be open to all candidates, regardless of gender, age, race, or sexual orientation." And I'm sure she gives the same spiel to every church she visits. And she personally visits every one of the 150 plus churches in the Minneapolis Area Synod when they begin to call a new pastor. And I'm sure she says this because it's easier for a church to decide in advance what kind of leader it thinks it needs, instead of allowing the Spirit of God to breathe into a call process like the Holy Spirit that Jesus breathed into the disciples in the story we hear today from the Gospel of John. Since the very beginning, the church has put requirements on who was worthy enough to lead the church. For some reason, feeling like they had to protect Jesus. This has been the central debate of many fights and rifts, deep hurt, and why people have left the church and social statements created. The church seems to forget about the Holy Spirit, who Jesus in this gospel refers to as the advocate, is the one who's called alongside of us as we make our way. The bishop's comments did not simply drop away as formality at that meeting. Leaders at Mount Olivet noted how important it was to publicly name that we needed to be open to all candidates. And so we wrote and we sent a letter even before any resumes were received. The letter stated this: "We are focused on the ability of the candidates to fulfill the needs of our church, and thus we have no restrictions or preferences other than finding the best fit for Mount Olivet. Mount Olivet is looking for a pastor who is called to our community and brings the gifts of preaching and worship leading, teaching and building relationships within Mount Olivet as well as our broader community. We seek a leader who has a heart for justice and advocacy, to lead our existing relationships and look for new ones with our many community partners." That letter publicly named the trust that we placed on the Holy Spirit rather than ourselves to connect this church with its next pastor, a pastor who would be called to lead here. And I think that letter also reminded us that not knowing what or who comes next is a part of this life of faith. And so, Joel, It wasn't long before your resume rose to the top of the pile, and the discernment began for you and for Mount Olivet. And I remember the conversation we had, knowing that you would be the first LGBTQ pastor called at this church. And you said to me, and you wrote to the community, that your life and call to be a pastor bears a fresh witness to the strong and inclusive love of God that reaches out in welcome to each of us exactly as we are. And so today, and for the week ahead, we celebrate the abundance of your call at Mount Olivet over these last 4.5 years. And we know that the stories contained in these years are now a part of our unfolding story. And without a doubt, Pastor Joel, we have seen in every way how you are so called to be a pastor. As you have grown, we have grown, and we are overjoyed that this calling in its official form began at Mount Olivet Lutheran Church in Plymouth. Your mom shared with me, Pastor Joel, that when you were only 2, your grandma said, "Kay, Joel is either going to be a politician or a pastor." Even that young, your grandma noticed your interest in others and your boundless communication skills emerging. There was no overlooking that you were called and destined to share your unique gifts tangibly and specifically to build community. Now, we tend to connect people who are like this, and I'm sure, Pastor Joel, people have seen our commonality and figured this is why we have become a strong, sometimes wily, pastoral team. But actually, it has been our differences of all sorts that have brought texture and expansive leadership to our shared call here at Mount Olivet. You are a millennial, and I am a Gen X. You're married to Ryan, and I'm married to Randy. You received your Master of Divinity from Yale Divinity School, and mine came from Luther Seminary. You and Ryan are double income, no kids. And Randy and I are parents to middle and high schoolers. You solve advanced crossword puzzles, and I craft fresh puns. You remember lines of scripture and hymns, and I remember names. You think deeply, I feel deeply. And even within areas of differences, we are both aware that we share the privilege of being white. And we continue to recognize that the church and the world still has so far to go to celebrate, not minimize, the differences, and to make a way for all who are called to lead and serve. Pastor Joel, when I think about your call here at Mount Olivet, there are 3 specific stories that stand out to me. The first is me, you, and Angela meet regularly to plan worship, and especially the seasons of the church. The coming back in fall, Advent, Epiphany, Lent, and Easter. And usually these meetings happen over cold cans of LaCroix and a bag of pistachios. And we rack our brains to find a theme that speaks to who we are here at Mount Olivet and where God is calling us in that time. And then we pick scripture and music, and we write prayers and plan for ways that the community can find meaning in worship and other opportunities. And it is you always, Pastor Joel, who offers to write the liturgy so that the prayers, the confession, and the blessing connect all of this together. And it takes a lot of time, and it requires way too many reply all emails to bring this together. And it's exhausting work, and we wonder if it's worth the time. Will anyone even notice? And you are always the one to bring me back when it feels like too much. And you say, Beth, this matters. It was a Wednesday night a few years ago, and you were teaching 7th and 8th grade confirmation, and the kids were scattered here in the sanctuary, and all of us were tired and antsy from a full day of work or a full day of school. And you stood in front of that baptismal font, and you talked about the identity we receive at baptism, a God who calls us just the way we are, even when the world keeps telling us that we're not enough or we should be something or someone else. And then you tied it all together with lyrics to a Taylor Swift song. And the restlessness in the room immediately stopped. And you could hear a pin drop because you made accessible the meaning of baptism in a way that kids could understand. And I have to say, for me too. And lastly, it was your wedding day. You and Ryan had so generously invited Mount Olivet to your wedding ceremony at Westminster downtown. It was your big day, and you had included the church where you were serving. And I remembered stepping up to read one of the scriptures in that high lectern and lifting my head to look out. And I could see from that high point all the seating sections of that huge sanctuary. And I noticed that one whole section was filled with Mount Olivet people. And every face was glowing with pride and joy. And even without words, I could read their minds. We get to be here. We wouldn't miss this for the world. And it was this wide extension of community, and it was a glimpse of the kingdom of God that started with an invitation and ended with an abundant response. You see, you have shown us, Pastor Joel, what it means to be called, and to proclaim that each of us is called in all the fullness of who we are. And the different ways is a gift we receive from each other. And that's what it means to be community. There's plenty of fear right now. We tend always to see the scarcity rather than the abundance. And I know I forget to trust. And I forget that I don't hold all of this on my own. And that is why we gather, whether it's in person or online or back and forth, to hear these stories that take us from unbelieving to believing and around again, because resurrection finds us when we are unsure of the next step, not knowing what comes next, and we see, like Thomas, that Jesus never leaves the humanness of our bodies or the woundedness that we both cause and hold. And the presence of God continues to come in the dailiness of this life. This is the holy ground. When we embrace the differences, when we look around to say who is here and who is not, and to know in all of the foolishness, imperfections, and missteps, we are each called, and we need all these varied calls as we make our way. And God's vision is to share all of this together. That is where community is formed and abundant life is found. Emily Dickinson wrote, "Not knowing when the dawn will come, I open every door." Pastor Joel, thank you for opening doors so we could see the dawn. And keep opening doors as you walk from here to your new call in Pittsfield, Massachusetts, to receive the beautiful calls of Zion Lutheran Church. Mount Olivet will keep opening doors as well. And even when the door seems shut, resurrection will still find us to breathe life again, to call us forth. Amen.
Thank you, band, and thank you, Pastor Beth, for that really meaningful sermon. During the song, someone had their finger hovering back and forth, like, love, care, angry, ha-ha, sad, wow. That's about right, isn't it? That's how it's been for me and will continue to be for me, all of it tangled together, all of it tangled together. Open doors, people walking through, possibility, you have made that a reality for 23 families in our metro when we totaled up all of your faithful giving over Lent to help assist families who have fallen behind in their rent or their utility bills, to help them stay in their house rather than face the prospect of a move, of homelessness, of uncertainty. You stepped up. We raised $34,700, 23 families who will never know that it was this church, and they don't need to know. What they need to know is that they have safe and stable housing, a place where they can continue to put down roots for their lives, raise their kids, connect themselves to the jobs and all the ways that they are called out in this world. In your small and large gifts, $500 worth of coins, we achieved more than 4.5 times of our original goal of 7,500. Prism will be so grateful, and I personally am so grateful. The cost of homelessness, by the way, is upwards of $36,000 per year in public spending per person. So, assuming an average family size of 3, our giving, which was generous, ended up saving about $2.5 million of costs, and also, more importantly, the trauma that comes, the lived and enduring trauma that comes with experiencing homelessness for those individuals who do. So we are grateful for the ways that we are generous toward one another. We have an opportunity to give now, to continue offering our gifts so that this church can be open. What is next? Who is God calling Mount Olivet to be? Not knowing is part of the story, and it's not a bad place to be. And in the not knowing, we still turn our hearts toward one another and toward God in generosity. So we invite you to give. And for those of you who tend to give week by week or sporadically, we recommend the Facebook giving button found on our Facebook homepage. If you're using a credit card, we get 100% of those donations. The credit card companies don't take a cut. So maximize your donation by using the Facebook Give button, but we are also happy to take your gifts however you're able to offer them. We also share peace, just as Jesus shared peace with his disciples. This peace that comes from God and passes between us is a sign of new life. And so as the band plays, as you offer your gift, receive and share this gift. The peace of God be with you all.
And also with you.
Oh my, I didn't know what it means to believe. Oh my, I didn't know what it means to believe. But if I hold on tight, is it true? Would you take care of all that I do? Oh Lord, I'm getting ready to believe. Oh my, I didn't know how hard it would be. Oh my, I didn't know how hard it would be. But if I hold on tight, is it true? Would you take care of all that I do? Oh Lord, I'm getting ready to believe. Be waving hands, singing freely, singing standing tall's not coming easy. No more looking down, honey, can't you see me? Oh Lord, I'm getting ready to believe. They'll be waving hands, singing freely, singing standing tall's not coming easy. No more looking down, honey, can't you see me? Oh Lord, I'm getting ready. Oh Lord, I'm getting ready. Getting ready to believe.
We celebrate communion each week as one church in many places. No matter who you are or where you are joining from, this is God's table, and that means there is a place for you here. Use whatever food and drink you have in your home, and know that if you do not share communion with us today, God's mercy still comes to you. Night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." We pray together using the words Jesus gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So when Ryan and I got married and we invited you all, it wasn't because we wanted to fill the pews of a very large church. It wasn't even because we like you, although we do like you. It was because we recognized that in order to live out the promises that we were making to each other, in order to live out our call as married husbands, we needed to know that we were supported. This life is too much to do on our own, and so God makes it so that we do not have to. And God calls each of us from the depths of who we are to live fully, that we might be connected and be gifted to others. That is what happens at this table. God gives us the strength and the food and the nourishment to affirm the hunger of our souls to be known by God and claimed by God. And then God gives us the courage to live out that call in community in the world. Even now, even today, it is a shock and a scandal that someone like me can stand behind this table and offer these gifts and these words to God's people, and over the internet too. High drama! But it is not I who am host here. It is the risen Jesus. The risen Jesus who will let no locked door keep him out, who will come through all the barriers that we put up to offer peace and to call us back into the world, into community. This bread and this wine, that is Jesus doing this for you, taking away your sin and your fear and giving you your strength and courage, connecting you deeply in the body of Christ. And it is the body of Christ that is given for you and the blood of Christ that is shed for you. Eat and drink in thanksgiving.
So blue, land of living God, grant your peace on earth. We can feel you move and cannot stay the same. The winds are blowing strong. God of heaven, come breathe peace. Breathe your peace on earth. So we might breathe you deep. this we can't explain. You overtake our souls. You come flooding in. You are the love we know. Bring us into you. God of peace, breathe your peace on us, that we might breathe you deep.
Body and blood of our risen Savior, strengthen you and keep you in God's grace now and forever. Amen. Before we are sent out into the world, we join our hearts as one in prayer. And just like that Facebook emoji reaction, some of the prayers we have are joyous, some are weighted down with concern. But what they have in common is that God hears them and that God promises to be with us as we pray. So if you have a prayer request this morning, whatever it is, if you would like to share it, please type it into the prayer or to the chat on our Facebook Live video, and we will be sure to pray. And I'll begin, and I have a couple specific prayers for folks in the congregation. So let us pray. God, for your resurrection love, which calls us out into the world, which makes us notice who is here and who is not here, which allows us to get comfortable with being uncomfortable, we give you thanks and praise, O God, for this resurrection love which never leaves us. God, in your mercy. God, we pray for Pam Lynn today, who had a major heart surgery, bypass surgeries over the weekend, and for her continued strength and healing. God, calm her, dwell with her, give her patience, and send your spirit of healing to Pam and all those that care for her up in Elk River. So God, in your mercy. And then ongoing prayers for you, Dan and Christy Coffin. Dan, as you live with brain cancer and receive treatment for it, Christy, as you care for Dan and for all the support that you are receiving and for all the questions that are still unanswered, and for these days, which are weighty and exhausting, we pray that they also might be holy and sacred, and that God may be made known in the midst of it. God, in your mercy. Kelly, thank you for that prayer of for God's guidance for me as Ryan and I head out to Massachusetts. It's no move is done without stress, and so we are praying that prayer as well for God to guide us, and we trust God to make a way, and we trust God will make a way for you to Mount Olivet. God, in your mercy. prayer of thanksgiving, Joyce, for the gift of Zoom and for your daughter, Marie, a pastor in Pennsylvania, and for the ways that worship, even in different distances, can bring us together. God, be made known in the realities of our day-to-day life. God, in your mercy. Joanne, prayer that God gives us exactly what we need to meet the demands of each day, especially for those days that seem too overwhelming. Yes, God doesn't give us 1 week at a time, a big chunk of mercy that we have to ration off. No, God's mercies are made new each morning, morning by morning. And that is a prayer for those of you who are walking with a lot, that I pray that you might know God's mercies rising each morning, that you don't have to take it more than one day at a time. God, in your mercy. Rita, for Lee and Stephanie, recently diagnosed with cancer, for treatment and a speedy and full recovery. God, for Lee and Stephanie and for all who live with cancer, we pray for treatment. We pray for full recovery. We pray that your work may be made known, not just in miraculous cures, but in the steady guidance of doctors and science, in the emotional support that we bring one another, and for the hope that nothing will put to death within us. God, in your mercy. Angela, for your friend Sarah, who is ending all treatment for cancer that has spread terminally, may she know your presence and love. God, hold Sarah and all who watch and wait with her. We know that death is not defeat, for you have defeated death in the cross and resurrection. And so we pray that your life, even as Sarah ends her life on earth, that your life may be made known, and that these days are sacred and meaningful, and that you are saturating them, God, in your mercy. Alana, for your host, Brother Diogo, in the hospital in Brazil for 2 weeks with COVID, for his healing, for his wife Paula and their two small children as they wait and wonder and worry, for this dear connection, cross-continental connection, for prayer and how it knows no bounds, and for the love and concern that we feel here, and for the trust that that somehow makes a difference in the heart of God and in the life of Diego. And so we pray for him as and for his health. God, restore him. God, send your spirit on him and all who live with COVID, especially in Brazil, and for peace, your deep peace for his wife and children as they wait and worry. Suzanne, for Jane, who underwent another back surgery this week, for her as she heals, God, send your spirit to watch over her and provide her what she needs. God, in your mercy. Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, both those prayers that we have typed and those prayers that we have kept on our hearts. We know that you are there, and we trust you because of Jesus, our risen Lord. Amen.
I want to introduce and welcome our newest members here at Mount Olivet, and they are actually online today, so please fill the comments with a welcome first for Jenny Anderson. Jenny moved from out east to Plymouth and heard from some good friends of hers to check out Mount Olivet Lutheran Church in Plymouth, and she did. Jenny's a speech therapist here in the community, and I marvel that Jenny jumped into Bible study just as she was experiencing worship online. And that's the thing about new members. How do you join a church when you can't be in a building? You can still join a church when you can't be in a building. And so Jenny, welcome, welcome, welcome. We are excited to get to know your story more. And as you have found us, we have found you a reminder of this ongoing call in this world. And then we welcome with joy Deb and John Bergstrand. They have been friends of Mount Olivet for a really long time, and Deb has just recently ended her call into full-time ministry with the ELCA, and what a gift to know, Deb and John, that you have chosen Mount Olivet to be your home church now. And we are excited to get to know Deb more and more this summer as she jumps in as interim pastor while I am away on sabbatical, and more to come to hear from Deb in the weeks to come, and for their whole family, and John, for your continued healing after your transplant surgery, for the ways that you have been sharing of yourself in this community, and now more and more richly as you join this church community. So let's, with emojis and such, welcome Jenny, Deb, and John to Mount Olivet. This beautiful reminder of that call, who's here, who's not, always changing, always growing, and that's leading us ahead. Some other announcements for us. We have a flower sale fundraiser. We are able to do mission trips this summer, one to Wilderness Canoe Base and another one to Colorado, to Sky Ranch for the high schoolers, and we're just celebrating how we can do this safely. But would you help out if you purchase flowers that invests in kids and their trip experience, and then you have some goodness to plant at your home or in your pots or wherever that garden finds you. And that deadline is next week, April 18th. And then, as Pastor Joel reminded us, we are back to yellow because cases have gone up, but what this means is we can for sure worship together outside, and we'll start that next week. So know anyone who would like to worship in person outside is able to do so. Angela's gonna drop the link momentarily, happening now. After church, we will have, Ryan is gonna be here with Joel, and we will have space for a receiving line so you can greet both of them, send them off with love. And then if you would prefer to drive up in your cars, you're welcome to do so. I think we're trying to do the in-person receiving line right after church, and then the car reception maybe after 12 o'clock. But whatever. It's going to work, and it's going to be really good. And I am really looking forward, as all of you, to worship next week outside, and the weather looks good. We are starting a new group called Living Faith Together, and this is all about connecting and naming, especially in parenting, the challenges that we have and those times when we feel like we're kind of experiencing something and can't find support or companionship along the way. And so this is a group to come in of and out of as you need, but really trusted conversations to name where you are and receive this perspective on life that's given in a community such as ours. So that's starting this week. You can find more information on the website. And then our community meal every Monday night. Usually we have more volunteers than we need, and in the upcoming weeks, Deb McDonald, who leads that, has informed us that we need some more volunteers. And so will you consider that, being a part of both feeding and being fed here at Mount Olivet? We'll drop that link in here as well. So I'm taking with me today, Joel, get comfortable with being uncomfortable. I think that is so very true. And my heart is very, very full right now. And so I leave you with this blessing. May our glorious God grant you a spirit of wisdom to know and love the risen Lord Jesus. The God of life, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Go in peace and share this good news. Alleluia. Thanks be to God.